Hi everybody, Reed Duke here. Welcome to a legacy video on channelfireball.com. Today I'm playing my old favorite deck, which is Elves. The deck list is relatively self-explanatory, especially given the fact that I really haven't changed much in many years of playing this deck. The additions from, you know, the modern era are mostly Allosaurus Shepherd and Once Upon a Time, which increase both the consistency and resilience of the strategy. But the actual gameplay of the deck has remained pretty much intact. What I'm going to do today is run this through a four-round Legacy preliminary event. So a lot of my Magic Online videos, I play through leagues, which are five rounds. Today's only going to be four, but it's a scheduled event, and hoping to put up a good showing. Now, I do want to remind you about my affiliate code, Reed. That's R-E-I-D. You can use this anytime you do business with Channel Fireball. In particular, you may want to look into signing up for Channel Fireball Pro. That's where all my written content goes up, as well as my teammates' written content, and specifically our deep dive articles, which are geared towards generally leveling up as a player and standing the test of time, rather than just being about the hot deck of any given week. So remember, if you want to do any business with Channel Fireball, affiliate code Reed. And thank you to the other sponsor of this video, which is Ultimate Guard. Ultimate Guard, I also encourage you to check out their online catalog or follow their Twitter account, as they have lots and lots of excellent products that you might be interested for storing or transporting your Magic cards. All right, I'll be back for round number one. Thanks for listening. All right, welcome to match number one. Let's get to some Legacy. All right, so I'm on the play, and my hand is pretty much just what you want. I only have one land, but the Green Sun Zenith is going to search for a second one, and then hopefully Eldritch Visionary can get me off the ground. So yeah, I'm going to keep and turn one Zenith for Dryad Arbor. Okay, generally, somebody with that start is going to be a favorable matchup for Elves. Elves is good at playing against opposing creature decks, especially Death and Taxes is pretty favorable. But that's not to say that it's a foregone conclusion. This is why we play the games, and I do have to make sure that I can get my mana underneath me before anything bad happens. All right, really not much to do this turn besides just play Elvish Visionary. Hypothetically, if I drew Gaia's Cradle, I could win the game this turn, but much more likely I'll just be passing. Sure. So if my opponent just plays Stoneforge Mystic or something like that, then I can play Shepherd and Heritage Druid and really get off the ground. But if they decide to Wasteland me, use Rishden Port, Swords to Plowshares, something, play a disruptive creature, things could get a lot more interesting. Well, opponent's in the tank, indicating choices, maybe just deciding between playing a creature or using Rishadin Port. That in itself could be a difficult decision from the opponent's perspective of, you know, do I slow down my own development in order to eliminate one mana from the opponent, or, you know, do I just play a creature and hope it works out? That's the type of play that's not obvious. You can't really autopilot that type of decision. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to port the Arbor. I am okay with this. All right, I drew Verdant Catacombs. So I think I should definitely start with Shepherd into Heritage. Then I'm going to make 3 mana and I guess the next thing to do is play Elvish Visionary. Okay, so this is indeed Death and Taxes. Mishra's Factory is not a universal card to have in Death and Taxes, but, you know, it makes sense. Okay, this should be pretty straightforward. Just Natural Order for Crater Hoof Behemoth. And I don't think it matters whether or not I play these creatures ahead of time. I have plenty of mana. And then I can get one extra attacker by using Wirewood Symbiote to untap a creature, and this is massive overkill. All right, so that's an illustration of what happens when things go smoothly in this matchup. As I mentioned, things don't always go smoothly. They can have Swords to Plowshares, they can have Mana Disruption, they can have disruptive creatures. So what I like to do is bring in definitely these four cards that can destroy a permanent. Progenitus, sometimes I bring it in. Though when things are going poorly, sometimes you can't cast Natural Order at all. So one option is to swap a Crater Hoof for a Progenitus and go a little harder on the Natural Order package. Another option is to cut it entirely or leave, like, for example, only one. Collector Oof. I guess this is a fine card against Vile and Umezawa's Chite. Allosaurus Shepherd is one of the weaker of the one drops, but it's never a bad idea to have more one mana elves in your deck. Why don't I do it like this? Okay, interesting opening hand. This has a good mix of lands and spells, but it's a little bit uninspired. Like Craterhoof Behemoth's probably the single worst card to have in my opening hand. I have no card draw engine. I have no Gaia's Cradle. So kind of like a speculative hand. What I do like about it is that I have plenty of lands against a deck that could be focused on Wasteland and Rishnan Import. I also like that I can just develop well in my first couple of turns, and then maybe by turn three, I'll have drawn, well, what could it be? Glimpse of Nature, Elvish Visionary, Green Sun Zenith, Once Upon a Time, potentially even Abrupt Decay or Assassin's Trophy would be good. I think this is a pretty borderline hand, and I'm gonna lean towards keeping it just because I like having my mana and place to make in the early turns. Certainly looked like they were contemplating a Swords to Plowshares, decided not to. Okay. Well, I can make a lot of mana. So if I play Nettle and Heritage, then I tap for three. Then I play Birchlore and Quirion. I can get up to four mana. I mean, I suppose just playing out all my stuff and then putting myself in a position where I can either start activating the Shepherd or maybe cast Craterhoof Behemoth. That sounds pretty good. Think I like just attacking with everything. And then I imagine my opponent won't block. They could block, which is not that bad for me. And then I can just end of turn Abrupt Decay, whatever their best card is, wait around to draw Visionary, Zenith, Cradle. a good play for my opponent. I guess I'm gonna bite. Interesting. What do I want to do with this Zenith? At this point, I think I'm going to get Quirion Ranger. Well, maybe not. Maybe Heritage Druid is better. Yeah, I think Heritage Druid's better. All right. I'm gonna try to hold the Heritage Druid for a possible Glimpse of Nature turn. My opponent seems to be passing with an instant open, because remember where there's a known Umezawa's Jitte that they're not playing out. And then I think I'm just passing. All right, I'll just untap. Okay, so start with 3 mana and Once Upon a Time. Thank you. So if I want to go for a glimpse turn, then I should take Quirion Ranger. If I want to go for a long-term grind them out type of strategy, then I want Visionary. I think I'm just going to go for a Ranger right now. And then glimpse. Cast Ranger. Use Ranger to untap Shepherd. Cast Ranger. That's real good. Yep, cast Nettle. Getting kind of close to casting the Crater Hoof. Say, for example, I use the Symbiote, I untap an Elf, I replay the Elf down to 3 mana, untap the Nettles, tap them again. Now I have 6 mana. Either way, it seems like I'm going to have to cast at least one more creature, so might as well just play the Oof. I'm actually out of gas. I have exactly enough to play. Oops. I haven't made a land drop yet, so I should have exactly enough to play the Crater Hoof. Okay, a nice start with some decent draws and a favorable matchup. I'll see you for round two. All right, welcome back for match number two, Legacy Elves. Remember, 4 round preliminary event. Currently 1-0. And, I have a really good hand with 0 lands and Once Upon a Time. So, first of all, let's evaluate how good this hand is if I hit a forest off of Once Upon a Time. It is really good, right? Like turn 1 Zenith for Arbor and then having Glimpse and Quirion Ranger. That's a very good start. So now let's evaluate what's the chance of failure on Once Upon a Time. My opponent could choose to Force of Will, but that's definitely, it's not a given that they're playing a Force of Will deck, not a given that they have Force of Will in their hand, and not a given that they would even choose to force it if they do have it. And then I have, 13 lands that are not Gaia's Cradle. That are not Gaia's Cradle or Dryad Arbor, plus 2 Dryad Arbors where, you know, that's not great, but it's at least not a clear disaster. Since this is Magic Online and not Arena, I'm actually going to bust out the calculator and find out what are the odds of hitting a forest. So you could do this using an online hypergeometric calculator. You probably didn't tune into you know, magic gameplay video for a math lesson, but it's pretty easy to, if you just Google hypergeometric calculator, you're going to get a really easy tool where it asks you, like, how many cards, what's your population size. That's 53 cards in the deck. Number of successes in population would be 13 good lands that I'm looking for, and then sample size of 5, I'm looking at 5 cards. And this is going to spit out the answer that the chances of getting a land in my top 5 are 77%, which that is not enough for me to want to keep this hand. I think if it had spit out, like, you know, 88%, then I would say yes, I'm willing to take a small gamble. But I'm actually going to decide to throw this one back. But super interesting decision. And then this hand, I'll just keep it and ship the Crater Hoof Behemoth because it's much worse, but definitely not going down to 5. Okay, so, yep, I guess we're going to start with Once Upon a Time. Interesting. You know, if I knew my opponent had a removal spell, I might choose to go for a redundant copy of Quarian Ranger or Heritage Druid. Not knowing what my opponent's playing, maybe Allosaurus Shepherd is a nice pick. Birch Lore lets me be a little bit more explosive. Like, for example, if I go Forest Birch Lore Ranger, then Quirion, Dryad Arbor, play another one drop. I'm going to go for the Shepherd. But boy, imagine how many challenging decisions you can have before you make your first land drop of a game. Seat of the Synod. Interesting. All right. 4 mana. Given that I have no idea what's going on, I'm kind of scared of attacking, like if there's going to be some Hole Breacher or a totally unexpected card. I might just take a little slow, play Quirion and Dryad Arbor. And then basically the goal is put myself in a position where I can win if I draw Glimpse of Nature, Natural Order, Green Sun Zenith, Elvish Visionary. Those are the key cards that I'm looking for here. And wow, there actually was a Hole Breacher. So I'm not going to say that was a specific read that I had, more of just I had absolutely no idea what was going on and didn't want to walk into something. All right. So Hole Breacher is actually going to turn off the visionary and glimpse angle. So this is looking pretty bad. I'm kind of want to find natural order as quickly as possible. Can also turn to like using Allosaurus Shepherd's ability. Why don't I just play out all my cards? Okay. Okay, so remember that with Allosaurus Shepherd, it turns all of my elves into 5/5s, but not Dryad Arbor or Symbiote. So what do I need in order to activate the shepherd? I can't do it without at least one, tap three of Heritage Druid. If I attack with all of my elves, no, all of my elves doesn't work. I have to leave back at least one. So if I attack with three elves, and then I want to activate Allosaurus Shepherd, I'm going to use Quirion Ranger to untap one elf. And I'd have to use Wyrewood Symbiote to untap another, which would mean returning an attacker to my hand anyway. So maybe I want to attack with just two elves. All right, take 10. All right. That's going to give my opponent a bunch of treasures off the Hole Breacher. So 7 fresh cards and 7 mana. What can they do with it? Then of course they can flash this back, so I imagine they're gonna find a win here. So Mentor means that my basic attack plan is not going to work. So I'm pretty much going to have to draw Natural Order to win this game. That's assuming I even get another turn. I mean, I'm just F6 at this point. Let's see what my opponent can do. Like I said, the only interesting question is if I draw exactly Natural Order, do I win the game? And, you know, the more tokens my opponent can generate, the more likely it is to be no. Keeping in mind that all these treasures make mana and they can also just use Urza's ability, so it's hard for them to really run out of gas. Okay, that's making a 32-32 construct token also, so that's going to neutralize one of my attackers. Okay. Hooray, I got a turn. I drew Once Upon a Time. I suppose I'll cast it. Gaia's Cradle makes it easy to activate the Shepherd, and also puts me in a position where I could draw Green Sun Zenith or Crater Hoof. So I guess I'll just play that and see if I can survive. So I have seven blockers. My opponent has the two constructs plus eight attackers with prowess. So that they would need to cast, you know, a fair number of spells to have lethal here. We'll say if they can get their monks up to 5/5, then, you know, I'm not going to have a very effective defense. Okay, they found Echo of Eon, so I'm sure that that's going to be enough. I think I'll pack it in there. Moving to sideboard, definitely interested in Collector Oof and then these four destroy target creature type of cards. Do I want Thoughtseize? Do I want Surgical Extraction? I think no to Surgical Extraction. I think I want some number of Thoughtseize, though potentially not the full four. Just wondering how much do I want the Visionary Symbiote stuff if they have Hull Breacher. Let's try it. I like this hand for sure. Turn two, Collector Oof. May do a lot of work. Urza actually gets through the Collector Oof ability, which is somewhat annoying. So option A is just Assassin's Trophy Urza. Option B, maybe play Visionary. I guess let's do that, Visionary. If there's ever a turn that I can get up to four mana, the trophy plus the oof might be really effective. Walking Ballista. Yeah, I think I'm beat. If I had found a land in either of those two last two draws, it would be a lot different. Even Quirion Ranger would have been really good this game. Yeah, so Urza allows artifacts to tap for blue mana, but it's Urza's ability, so it's kind of a foil to Collector Oof. And I never had enough time, enough traction to get the Assassin's Trophy and the Oof off the ground, given that I was missing land drops. If I'd had Quirion Ranger, then it's like turn one, Zenith. For Dryad Arbor, then turn two, I can go like Heritage Druid and Quirion Ranger, untap the Dryad Arbor, play a third elf, then I have a lot of traction. All right, so all my permanents are artifacts, and I can't use artifacts abilities, so these 2/1/1 creatures would have to do awful lot of work, and that's not gonna happen. All right, I'll be back for round three. Hey, welcome back. We're about to start match number three. I just have a moment of a quick debrief from the end of the second game two of match two there, where I conceded to Karn plus Mycosynth Lattice. I realized actually that Karn had only one loyalty, and I could have hypothetically attacked with my 2/1s into the Urza and killed the Karn, which of course would have been better than conceding. You know, anything's better than conceding. But, you know, I think it's okay, so to speak, because I was pretty far behind on in every metric of that game. So I think, you know, me losing was the fair and likely outcome. Although I did just want to point out that play that I could have made in order to continue playing. Hey, sorry for that little jump. I paused the video to work through a significant delay, but you just saw me, or you missed me casting turn one Zenith for Arbor. Just a normal opening for this deck, and then my opponent played an island and passed back, so let's get to it. My draw is virtually perfect here. And, I mean, I think I can basically just go for it. Glimpse, followed by Quirion Ranger, untap Arbor, Heritage Druid, then Gaia's Cradle. This could easily be a win if my opponent doesn't have anything to contest it. Turn two win is pretty rare for elves, but it does happen. And note that this is not a guaranteed turn two win, but it's a pretty good spot. Like, I can draw several cards with access to several remaining mana, so if I'm able to find a Nettle Sentinel or a good combination of cards, you know, I could get there. However, turn one basic island go after not mulliganing, I think it makes it really likely that I'll run into Force of Will, Force of Negation, Spell Pierce, Daze, Flusterstorm, you name it. One thing that I haven't talked about so far in the banning in the video is Elves' position after the most recent wave of bannings in Legacy. I think Elves was already a good deck, but was a significant winner, especially from the banning of Dreadhorde Arcanist. The Elves matchup has historically been close, often favorable for Elves, but that Dreadhorde Arcanist card made it very easy for them to kind of hammer you by playing this turn two creature and then flashing back lightning bolts every turn or just burying you in value. So the banning of Dreadhorde Arcanist, I think, changes a really important matchup from even or unfavorable into favorable again. That's a really good place to be for Elves. Okay, so Spell Pierce gonna counter the Glimpse of Nature. That's effectively a hard counter because if you think about it, you know, if I'd played my land and then tapped the two for Spell Pierce, Glimpse would resolve, but I'd have no creature to play. So that works, and then what do I want to do next? I guess Ranger and Visionary off the Cradle sounds good. And then if I draw something spicy, I could use the Quirion Ranger to get Heritage Druid out there. But my default is to not do that because it's going to set me back a land drop. My opponent sent me a message, by the way, that he was going to be distracted for a few minutes, which I'm really grateful for that message because it allowed me to kind of edit the videos to get rid of some of that downtime. But, you know, hopefully we'll have the opening turns of this game be a little slow and then things will turn back to normal. What do we deduce from basic island spell pierce? Kind of seems like a combo deck. I actually know this player, JPA93, kind of a famous Magic Online Legacy player. And often they play show and tell decks, so that would fit so far. Basic island, as opposed to it being like Volcanic Island, makes it more likely to be a combo deck and less likely to be Delver. And then spell pierce kind of rules out storm combo, so show and tell is very likely, I think, at this point. That is an unfavorable matchup for elves, but given that I have a really good draw on the play here, I think, you know, the match is still up for grabs, despite it being generally an unfavorable matchup. Show and tell decks are generally like half a turn faster than elves. Plus, it's easier for them to disrupt you with a Force of Will than it is for you to disrupt them. Elves has effectively no disruption in game one. So to recap, if I draw any normal card here, I'm just passing the turn. But if I draw Wirewood Symbiote, maybe another Visionary, then I may go ahead and get the Druid onto the battlefield via Quarian Ranger. But drawing another land, you know, I definitely don't want to set myself back a land drop, so I can just go ahead and pass. Next turn, let's say for the sake of argument, I go Wooded Foothills for Dryad Arbor, cast Heritage Druid, then I tap Cradle for 5. Tap my 3 elves, I can cast Crater of Behemoth and maybe score a win. Okay, let's see. Oh, that is the best draw I could have had. That's just terrific. Uncounterable Crater Hoof. Nice. Okay, so if I assume it's a show and tell deck, I'm just going to board in my four Thought Seizes and cut some of the clunkier stuff or stuff that's more vulnerable to Force of Will. I guess just something like this. Totally solid hand. Ooh, that's not a good scene. The main question here is, would I rather have the Crater Hoof in my library or in my hand? I have one natural order in my deck. I think I'd generally rather have it in my hand. Yep. Show and tell, ponder. Well, if I had multiple Thought Seizes, this might be more interesting, but I'm just going to take ponder. Presumably my opponent hid, a Grizzlebrand or an Emrakul or something. But there's not much I can do about that. Yeah, I don't think we need to play this one out. A couple of pretty lopsided games there. And then going to game three, at least I get to go first. Yeah, I guess this can work. It's a ponder and a no shuffle. Alright, I think I'm just gonna attack, play Thoughtseize, and play Dryad Arbor. I could do some stuff with Quirion Ranger and bounce the Bayou to get another cast out of that, but I think this is a top priority anyway. So remember, we had a ponder and a no shuffle. And my opponent's definitely well set up here. I think I have to take the Pyroclasm and just try to race. Like, I think they're, given that I have to leave my opponent with the full combo, there is just no way I'm beating Pyroclasm. Like, I won't have enough time to rebuild. So, put on your racing shoes. I may actually win this. I have to get a lot of attackers out there, but there's no disruption. This is as straightforward as it gets. Okay, here goes nothing, right? Basically, I need to get the Behemoth onto the battlefield, and I need to be able to attack with all of these three original creatures. So, 1, 2, 3. Play the Quirion. Play the Shepherd. And then untap the Visionary. Hooray, I beat turn 2 Emrakul. All right, I'll be back for the fourth and final round. Okay, welcome back for the fourth and final round of Legacy Elves. I'm currently 2-1, hoping to get that third win. And remember, a lot of my videos are 5-round league style videos, but this is a 4-round preliminary event, so this is going to be the last match for today. But don't worry, plenty more video content from me and my teammates on the Channel Fireball YouTube channel. This hand is acceptable. You can often work pretty well with one-landers when you have Quirion Ranger. And one of the things I like about this particular deck list is my main deck is entirely green, so against an opponent who may or may not have Wastelands, I am totally fine just searching for basic forest. Could it be a mirror match? Well, mirror match is not great when you've lost the die roll, because it's just basically a race. My opponent did mulligan though, so maybe they won't be able to piece together a turn 3 win. there any way I can get a turn two win with this? It's tricky because, you know, hypothetically, I could natural order for a Crater Hoof, but I would have only the Nettle Sentinel as a valid attacker, so I'd have to have, what is that, like, six creatures on the battlefield, seven creatures on the battlefield. All right, well, my opponent is pretty well set up if they have virtually anything, so let's see what I can do on this turn. Comboing off on hard mode when you have only one forest to work with. So let's say I go Ranger down to 2 mana, untap something, then up to 5 mana. Then I could natural order, but again, we're not quite at the... So if I have 7 creatures on the battlefield, then I get to attack with a 12-12 and a 9-9 for 21 damage. It would force my opponent to chump block with both creatures. So that's about the minimum that is going to be effective. If I have 6 creatures, then I attack for exactly 19. I force one chump block. Maybe that's something. Okay, let's say for the sake of argument, I play Ranger, Heritage Druid, then tap 3 elves up to 4 mana. Then I play Wirewood Symbiote. Then I bounce a Quirion, untap something, replay Quirion down to 2 mana. That might work. I'm just, I guess, trying to figure out if the Elvish Visionary does anything for me. I think the answer is no. Well, Visionary, untap something with Quirion Ranger, then tap 3, then I'm up to 5 mana, then the Symbiote. Okay, so yeah, that it still works and it gets me an extra creature on the battlefield, so that's good. Shepherd. And now I'm attacking for 23 trample, which is just enough to guarantee lethal. Comboing off on hard mode, that's a turn two win. Now, my secret to the Elves Mirror is that there is no secret. I think you want to change very little about your deck and just focus on comboing quickly. I think people have a lot of temptation to bring in stuff like Thoughtseize and Abrupt Decay, But my experience is that casting those, drawing and casting those cards typically slows me down by more than it slows the opponent down. So especially when I'm on the play, I change almost nothing. On the draw, you kind of need to do something special to break serve. So I don't hate the idea of bringing in like between one and three Thought Seizes, but this is going to be minimal sideboarding. So could trim, I guess, Allosaurus Shepherd's probably my weakest card. Maybe just minus two Shepherd, plus two Thought Seize. Okay, so this hand I think has very little hope of a turn two kill, but I probably want to keep it if a turn three kill is likely. Let's engage that question. Turn one, Zenith for Arbor. Turn two, play some elves, and then turn three, Natural Order is really likely. What if I don't have a creature in my top two cards? Then what happens? Then I can't use the Heritage Druid for mana. But I think it would still be okay because I could just cast Natural Order for four. So I'll keep, though it's pretty expected that if my opponent has a good draw on the play, I'll just not get a third turn at all. Okay. Found Allosaurus Shepherd. All right, do your worst, opponent. Maybe not literally. Maybe don't do your worst. Do your second worst. If they have a Gaia's Cradle, they're going to be in very good shape here. They do. All right. Lots of mana and lots of cards. My chances of seeing a turn three are steeply declining. Wow, did they fizzle? Really? Amazing. So now I should be in good shape to just play out as many creatures as possible in natural order. Anything tricky about how I want to navigate this? Again, the objective is to have as many attackers as possible. So if I just play my two elves, tap three elves, tap my Dryad Arbor. Well, I guess it's straightforward, except that I can't search for another arbor, which would be another creature for the natural order. But if I just search for forest, tap my three lands, play two elves, tap three elves, natural order, then untap an attacker, I'm going to have four attackers with all plus five plus five. So that'd be 28 damage trample, and that should work. All right, winning the Elves Mirror for a 3-1 record. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I'll see you next time.